so the following evening, I brought Jim home to dinner. I have known Jim slightly in high school. In high school, Jim was a hero. He had tremendous Irish good nature and vitality, with a scrubbed and polished look of white china on. He seemed to move in a continual spotlight. He was a star of the basketball team, captain of the debating club, president of the senior class and the glee club, and he sang the male lead in the annual light opera. He was forever running or bounding, never just once. He seemed always just at the point of defeating the law of gravity. He was shooting with such velocity through his adolescence that you were just logically expected to arrive at nothing short of a White House by the time he was through. But Jim apparently ran into more interference after his graduation from high school because his speed and deference slowed. And so, at this point in our lives, he was holding a job that wasn't much better than mine. He was the only one in the warehouse with whom I was on friendly terms. I was valuable to Jim as someone who could remember his former glory, who had seen him win basketball games and the Silver Cup in the debating game. He knew of my secret practice of retiring to a cabin in the washroom whenever business was slack at the warehouse. He called me Shakespeare. And while the other boys in the warehouse regarded me with suspicious hostility, Jim took a humorous attitude towards me. Gradually, his attitude began to affect the others, and their hostility wore off. And so, after a time, they began to smile at me too, as people would smile at some oddly fashioned dog that trots across their path at some distance. I knew that Jim and Laura had known each other in high school, because I heard my sister Laura speak admiringly in Jim's voice. I didn't know if Jim would remember her or not, because in high school, Laura had been as unobtrusive as Jim had been astonishing. And even if he did remember her, it wasn't as my sister. For when I asked him home to dinner, he just smiled and said, "You know, funny thing, Shakespeare, I never thought of you as having a voice."
know Shakespeare? I'm going to tell you a little good.
Okay.
Of course I'm kidding.
Of course.
Of course I'm public speaking. You know, you and me, we're not the warehouse types.
Thanks, that's good news. What's public speaking got to do?
It fits you for executive position. I tell you, it's been a hell of a lot for me.
In what respect?
In all respects. Ask yourself, what's the difference between you and me and the guys in the office down front? Brains? No. Ability?
No.
Then what? Primarily, it amounts to just one single thing.
What is that one thing?
Social importance. The ability to square up to anybody and hold your own in any social level.
Yes, Mother.
Is that you, Mr. O'Connor?
Yes, Mother.
They sell control.
We will.
Ask Mr. O'Connor if he'd like to wash his hands.
No thanks, ma'am. I took care of that down at the warehouse. Tom?
What?
Mr. Mendoza was speaking to you.
Favor?
What do you think?
Well,
you're going to be out of the job if you don't wake up.
I'll wake up.
Yeah, you show no signs.
The signs are material. I'm just about to make a change. I have been on the verge of a future that doesn't include a warehouse or Mr. Mendoza or even a night school course in public speaking.
Now what are you gassing about?
I'm tired of the movies.
The movies?
Yes. Look at them. All the movies. Heavy adventures. All you know, gobbling the whole thing up. You know what happens? People go to the movies instead of moving. Hollywood characters are supposed to have the adventures for everybody in America. Well, everybody in America sits in a dark room and watches them happen. Yes, until there's a war. That's when adventure becomes available to the masses. Everyone's pitch, not just gamers. And then the people in the dark room come out of the dark room and have some adventures themselves. Pretty good. It's our turn to go to South Seattle. To make a safari, so to be exotic, far off. But I'm not patient. I don't want to wait until then. I'm tired of the movies, and I'm about to move.
Move?
Yes.
When?
I'm starting to boil inside. I know I seem dreamy, but inside, well, I'm boiling. Whenever I pick up a shoe, I shudder a bit, thinking how short life is and what I'm doing. Look.
What?
I'm a veteran.
Union emergency?
Yeah. I paid my dues this month instead of the electric light bill.
You're going to regret it when they turn off the lights.
I won't be.
Yeah, but how about your mother?
Well, I guess I'm like my father. The bastard son of a bastard. See how he grins? And he's been absent going on 16 years.
You're just talking, you drip. How does your mother feel about it?
I wouldn't talk about this with Mother. Mother's not acquainted with my plans. Yes, Mother?
Where are y'all?
On the terrace, Mother.
Why don't you come in?
Mother, you look so pretty.
You know, I think prepared for what the future brought me. All my gentlemen callers were sons of planters and planters, so I assumed that I'd marry one and raise my family in a large piece of land, many a servant. The man proposes, and the woman accepts the proposal. That gal was my own man up there. Telephone man. Fell in love a long distance. Now he doesn't travel, and I don't even know where. But what am I going to do, going on with my tribulations? Tell me about yours, although I hope you don't have any. Tom!
Yes, ma'am?
What about supper?
Well, supper's on the table.
Oh, so it is. How lovely. Where, Flora?
Laura's feeling not doing so well. She thinks maybe she better not come to the table.
Laura!
Yes, Mother?
Mr. O'Connor?
Thank you, ma'am.
We can't eat dinner. Please come out here.
She's feeling better.
sitting way over there.
I can't see you.
Yeah, but that's no fair. I'm right here in the limelight. I judge you being an old-fashioned type of girl. Oh, I think that's a wonderful type to be. I hope you don't think I'm being too personal, do you?
Mr. O'Connor?
Hmm?
I will take a piece of gum, if you don't mind. Mr. O'Connor? Have you kept up with your singing?
Singing? Me?
Yes. I remember what a beautiful voice you had.
You heard me sing?
Oh, yes. Very often. Don't suppose you remember me at all?
You know, it seemed like I was just about to remember your name. I thought I'd seen you before somewhere. But the name I was about to remember wasn't a name. So I stopped myself before I said it.
Wasn't it Blue Roses?
Yes, yes. That's what it was. It was Blue Roses. Gosh, I didn't know that you were Shakespeare's sister. Gee, I'm sorry.
I didn't expect you to. You barely knew me.
But we didn't have a speaking acquaintance.
Yes, we spoke to each other.
Say, didn't we have a class in something together?
Yes, we did.
What class was that?
It was singing, chorus. I sat across the aisle from you in the auditorium. Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays.
I remember now. You were the one who always used to come in late.
Yes. It was so hard for me getting upstairs. I had the leg brace on that time. It clumped so loud.
I never heard any clumping.
To me, it sounded like thunder.
I never even noticed.
Everybody was sitting before I came in. I had to walk in front of all those people. My seat was in the back row. I had to go clumping up the aisle with everyone watching.
Oh, gee, you should have been self-conscious.
I know, but I was. It was always such a relief when the singing started.
And I remember now. I used to call you Blue Roses. How did I ever get started calling you such a silly name like that?
I was out of school for a while with the roses. When I came back, you asked me what was the matter. I said I had the roses.
Yeah, I guess being shy is something you have to get over when you're graduating.
Yeah, I guess it
takes time.
Yes.
Say, you know something, Laura? People are not so dreadful once you get to know them. That's what you have to remember. And everybody has problems. Not just you, but practically everybody has problems. You think of yourself as being the only one who's disappointed. But just look around you and what do you see? A whole lot of people just as disappointed as you are. You take me, for instance. Boy, when I left high school, I thought I'd be a lot further along than I am now. Say, you remember that wonderful write-up I had in the door?
Yes, I do.
Said I was bound to succeed in anything I went into. Holy Jesus! The torch!
Who you are? In the Pirates of Penzance.
The Pirates. Oh, better far to live and die under the brave black flag I fly. I sing beneath that operator.
So beautifully. Yes. Beautifully.
You heard me then, huh?
I heard you all three times.
No.
Yes.
You mean all three performances?
Yes.
What for?
I wanted to ask you to autograph my program.
Why didn't you?
You were always surrounded by your own friends so much that I never had the chance.
Oh, you should have just come right up to me and said,
I thought I might think
it was what?
Oh, yeah.
I was beleaguered by females in those days.
You were terribly popular.
Yeah.
You had such a friendly way.
Oh, I was spoiled in high school.
Everybody liked you.
Who knew?
Why, yes. I did too.
Give me that program, Laura. There you are. Better late than never.
Night? What a surprise.
My signature's not worth very much these days. But maybe someday, it will improve or increase in value. You know, being disappointed is one thing and being discouraged is something else. Well, I may be disappointed, but I'm not discouraged. Say, you finished high school?
I made bad grades during final examinations.
You mean you dropped out?
I didn't go back. Indigestion.
got to think of yourself as superior in some way.
In what way? What I think?
Why, man alive, Laura, look around you a little, and what do you see? A world full of common people, all of them born and all of them going to die. Not which of them has one tenth of your strong points, or mine, or anybody else's for that matter. You see, everybody excels in some one thing. Well, some advantage. You take me, for instance. My interest happens to lie in electrodynamics. I'm taking a course in radio engineering at night school, on top of a fairly responsible job at the warehouse. I'm taking that course and studying public speaking.
Oh, my.
Because I believe in the future of television. I want to be ready to go right up along with you. Oh, I've already made the right connections. All that remains now is for the industry itself to go underway. You know, full steam. You know, knowledge, money. I guess you think I think a lot of myself.
No, I don't.
Well, now how about you? Isn't there some one thing that you take more interesting than anything else?
Yes, I do, as I said, have my glass collection.
Oh, you do? What kind of glasses?
Little articles. Ornaments, mostly. Some of them are little animals made out of glass. Some of the mother calls them the glass menagerie. Here's an example of one, if you'd like to see it. This is one of the oldest. It's nearly 13. Oh, be careful. If you breathe, it breaks.
I better not take it. I'm pretty clumsy.
Go on. I trust you. There. You're holding it gently. Hold him over the light. He loves the light. See how the light shines through him?
It sure does shine.
I shouldn't be partial, but he is my favorite one.
Say, what kind of thing is this one supposed to be?
Haven't you noticed the horn on his forehead?
Oh, a unicorn, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Unicorns, aren't they extinct in the modern world?
I know.
Poor little fellow must feel kind of lonesome.
Well, if he does, he doesn't complain about it. He sits on a shelf with some other horses, and they seem to get along nicely together.
They do. Say, where will I put him?
Put him on the table. They all have a table.
They do. Look how big my shadow is when I stretch.
Oh yes. It stretched clear across the ceiling.
Stop raining. Where does the music come from?
From the Paradise Dance Hall, across the alley.
Thank you.
you bet I can. They walk all over the earth. You just stay here. There's calmness between them. But you, well, you're blue roses.
But who is wrong for roses?
It's right for you. You're pretty.
In what respect am I pretty?
In all respects. Your hair, your eyes, your hands are pretty. You think I'm saying this? I've been invited over to dinner at half of the night. Oh, sure. I can do that. I can say lots of things without being sincere. But I'm talking to you sincerely. I happen to notice you have this inferiority complex that keeps you from feeling comfortable with people. Somebody ought to build your confidence up. Way up. To make you proud. Instead of shy. Turning away. And blush. Somebody ought to kiss you, Laura. You know. there last summer on a moonlight boat trip up the river to Alton on the Majestic. Well, right away from the start, it was love. Love has made a new man of me, boy. The power of love is pretty tremendous. Love makes the whole world go round. It just so happened that Betty's aunt took sick, and she got a wire and had to go to the college. So naturally, when Mom asked me to dinner, naturally I accepted, not knowing. I mean, not knowing. I wish that you could say something. What do you want that for? You mean you want me to have it? What for?
A souvenir.
Success and happiness.
brightly colored, but torn away from the branches. I would have stopped, but I was pursued by something. It came upon me altogether unawares. Perhaps it was a familiar bit of music, perhaps it was a piece of transparent glass. Perhaps I'm walking in some strange city before I found my companion's hand, and I passed the light of the room and shot up her hidden soul. The window was filled with tiny bits of colored glass, tiny transparent bottles, and delicate rainbow colors. And then, all of a sudden, my sister touched my shoulder. I turned around and looked into her eyes. Love, I tried to make you believe, but I was more crazy than I intended to be. So I reached for a cigarette, I crossed the street, I run into a bar, I buy a drink, I talk to the nearest stranger. Anything to divert your attention.